From CGTN headquarters in Beijing, this is The Hub with Wang Guan.
Hello and welcome to the program. I'm Wang Guan in Beijing. The China Central Asia Summit has just concluded in Xi'an in northwestern Chinese Shanxi province. Being the first major diplomatic activity held on the Chinese home turf, the summit reached a wide-ranging consensus from economic cooperation to security issues of mutual concern. While focusing on the big agenda, my trip to Xi'an also impressed me in many other ways, more thorough and subtle. I had the best Chinese burger, rou jiamu, the best I've had in my life, and also the traditional Chinese artist, the cartoonist, who, yep, there you go. That was the rou jiamu, the best I've had. Highly recommend it if you haven't tried. Also, I've met friends, as you can see, Kazakh students speaking fluent Chinese, Chinese cartoonist, painting for guests from around Central Asia. That was an awesome experience. And for many people, when we talk about relations between countries, it could be a rather abstract notion, but the reality on the ground is much simpler. It's all about people-to-people interactions. As the summit has shown, it's about bringing different cultures much closer and creating a very special and enduring bond. Now, first of all, let's take a look at our interview done by my colleague Wang Naiqian with Er Qiao, a cartoonist who drew much attention during this summit in Xi'an for his vivid cartoon depictions with a twist.
Well, truly amazing story there. And guess what? Er Qiao also painted
for us, CGTN, a very special cartoon. Well, actually, this is me, right here. Well, I think it's pretty good, no? And this is a recent leader that we've interviewed on CGTN on China Media Group. And here he said, long live China-Kazakhstan friendship. Thank you very much, Artel, if you're watching this program. Much appreciated. Now, coming up, we are introducing you a very special and dear friend of ours, Xiao Yun. She's a current student, a senior at Xi'an Petroleum University, Xi'an Shiyu Dashue. We met during the summit, and she was actually volunteering and translating for us, facilitating our interviews. Xiao Yun, it's wonderful to see you again. First of all, how do you feel that the summit is over? All your Kazakh friends are back home, you're back to school. Are you having a mental hangover?
I would say so. After the summit was over, it feels very quiet. When the summit started, it felt very different for me. It was really busy. And my student life, especially these days, it's pretty quiet. It's very peaceful. I only do my thesis and I'm just busy with that. But these summit days, they were crazy. Like, I was running around, translating here and there. But it was fun for me, like, really fun.
And we're talking about the fact that there were many Kazakh students studying in China in their thousands. And due to COVID, there are less number of them studying right now. But there could be a rebound, right? With this summit in place, there could be a lot more students studying in China from Central Asia, such as yourself. What do you think?
Yes, I really hope that more of Kazakhstan students will start coming back to China because, yes, when the pandemic hit, Kazakhstan flew all of our students back home. And since then, we right now only have like 30 to 40 students in Xi'an. And that's a little bit sad because before I remember the days when so many Kazakhstan students used to meet up or do some things, or especially on our own Kazakhstan festivals. We used to meet up and cook our traditional food and everything like that. And hopefully after the summit over, and especially with all the new opportunities that are coming over, I think we'll be seeing more of Kazakhstan students coming back to China.
Well, finally, I want to ask you, Xiaoying, about this summit. From the perspective of you being a Kazakh student in China, I understand that you've been in China on and off for, what, 6 years? How do you look at this summit?
I feel like this summit was a historical event for all of the five countries from Central Asia, as also China, of course, all the six countries. I think this is, of course, this is not the first step, when first time when all Central Asian countries and China had any relationships going on. So, but this is one of the biggest times, and especially after COVID, this is the time when they actually met face, like, next to each other, not the online meetings. And I think we can wait for very big changes or opportunities happening, connections between all of these six countries.
All right, Xiaoyun, thank you very much for what you have done for our team, for our crew, and for the summit. I hope to see you again soon, either in Beijing or Xi'an. Okay, take care there.
Okay, bye.
Really, it's like people, you know, civilian ambassadors of Artel and Xiaoyun, they're making this summit a great success. Now, as we're embracing even greater regional solidarity, how has the Western countries reacted? And how will the China-Central Asia summit affect the geopolitical landscape that we're witnessing? For more discussions, let's loop in our panelists for today. I'm joined here in our Beijing studio by Han Hua. She's the president of Beijing Belt and Road Cooperative Community. And also in Tashkent, Uzbekistan, we have Dr. Ulugbeck Khasanov, former aide to the Uzbek president and also head of Regional Security and Development Study Lab. Welcome to both of you. Let's start with you. Hi. Han Hua, it's so good to see you. I understand that recently you were in Uzbekistan. Now you're witnessing this event unfolding, China Central Asia Summit. What do you see as the most important outcomes from this China Central Asia Summit?
I think this summit is bringing another new milestone to the Central Asia countries and the relationship between Central Asian countries and China. As I pointed out in many articles and in our discussion with the think tanks over there, we both see this a bridge. I mean, being Central Asian countries, it can play a very and more important role being a bridge to connect East and West, to connect China, being the second largest economy in the world, and the rest of the world, which is Europe, which is some other countries in the Middle East, as well as others, in developing the developing not only the trade relations, but also to continuing a globalization in the new context of this turbulent world.
Now we know that in Xi'an there were 20 to 30 bilateral and multilateral meetings in place. There were dozens of deals signed between China and Central Asian counterparts, cooperative agreements covering infrastructure, green energy, people-to-people exchange. What do you think are the highlights, and how do you think these agreements will really affect the lives of people in China and in Central Asia?
There are many general proposals and agreements between China and Central Asian countries as a whole, but also there are many interesting proposals and agreements in particular for each respective countries. For example, for Uzbekistan, they are more concerned about its green development down the road, and it is also concerned about whether and how China's alleviation of poverty, the practices and lessons learned, can be also learned for them. And they are even interested about the medical care for the elder people in rural areas during our discussions with the think tanks and with the experts there. So I think in general, there are a lot of agreements. I learned that each country has signed the bilateral declaration, and among each, there are about over 30 proposals, and they are in very detailed execution plans, for example, like the energy cooperation, like the grain cooperation, like the automobile manufacturings. So I think for the people in China and the Central Asia, this is a continuous development along the Belt and Road Initiative in first, and also there will be some exact details for the people to raise their livelihood, just as I mentioned. For example, the tourism between China and Uzbekistan will certainly be boosted because of the mutual waiver visa policy.
Is there a waiver of visa right now, just like China-Kazakhstan?
Yes, the 10 days visa, and we are hoping to maybe to expand this visa waiver days from 10 days to even 1 month, so that the Chinese tourists will have more time and the chances to visit more than Tashkent and Samarkand to some other Asian countries.
You're saying that right now, if a person is holding a Chinese passport, he or she can go to Tashkent, can go to Uzbekistan for 10 days without needing a visa.
Without a visa. It is even more convenient if you take a high-speed train from Tashkent to Samarkand. It will only take you about 2 hours from a capital modern city to an ancient Silk Road city.
Yeah, certainly. I can tell the excitement through your eyes about your trip in Uzbekistan, which was, 10 days? We'll talk about that later. Dr. Khasanov, I'm wondering, how is the China Central Asia Summit covered and perceived by people, by scholars like yourself back home in Uzbekistan? What do you think are the highlights, the important outcomes from this summit?
In my view, China-Central Asia Summit in Xi'an played a significant role in the process of further deepening of strategic partnership between Uzbekistan and China. And our President Shavkat Mirziyoyev mentioned it several times in different meetings that the current and future partnership with the People's Republic of China has strategic importance for further industrial and innovative development of our national economy. That's why we have many, many important things in store for the bilateral relations, for further deepening and developing our mutual relations and the partnership. That's why Xi'an Declaration mentioned that we Central Asians share with China common destiny. That means that we have more things, I would say, integrating and connecting this region, I mean the Central Asia, with China through the historical, cultural, industrial, trade, logistical vectors of our relations. That's why Central Asia and China has strategic agenda for further development and is fantastically perceived not just by academia or scholars or educational system, but by the ordinary people. They received and they accepted it as a new stage, as a new step for further deepening of people-to-people communication. That is very important for our bilateral relations.
Dr. Khasanov, specifically for China and Uzbekistan, we understand that Uzbekistan has the largest population in Central Asia, nearly 50% of them, and also it is the fastest growing economy in the last couple of years. What do you think this summit will bring to China and Uzbekistan, especially in terms of trade and investment opportunities?
No, as far as you know, at the end of the summit, and in a frame of Uzbek president's state visit to China just recently, both sides reached and signed agreements on 41 documents, and that means 41 aspects of our bilateral relations. If we mention the previous documents and the previous joint projects, I would say compared with the previous statutes and the previous projects and the elements in our bilateral relations, today's level is doubling. That means that we are in a process of seriously reconsidering and deepening our relations with China. I would say to you that before 2016, the general volume of our bilateral trade did not exceed 5 billion, but today it is doubled within 4-5 years since Shavkat Miromanovich Mirziyoyev came to the power, since at the end of the 2016, the dramatic changes had happened in the regional climate, regional atmosphere, and in the context of our relations with our strategic partners, where China is playing the role of the leading trade and economic partner for the Uzbek economy. And then I agree with my colleague when she said that the Uzbekistan in the process of further deepening the whole agenda of bilateral relations. That's why we are considering and accepting the current and the future state of our relations as very perspective and strategic for the needs and interests of the Republic of Uzbekistan.
Definitely a lot of benefits down the line for people on both sides. President Han Hua, I understand you were in Uzbekistan for what, 10 days? Yes. You met people from the foreign ministry, the office of the president, also major think tanks. How did that trip change your perception about Uzbekistan and China-Uzbekistan relations?
You know that so well.
I did my homework.
Yes, and I'm happy to share with you that before going to Uzbekistan, I know it is an ancient Silk Road country, and it has a lot of historic relics, and I was looking forward to see, you know, even the war paintings left by, explored by the archaeologists regarding the Tang Dynasty's prosperity and the cultural exchange between the two countries in ancient times. But now I can see we might be in the different development stage, I mean the two countries, in terms of economic growth, but certainly the two countries are moving towards the same direction, which is people-centered, people-satisfied strategy, and I was honored to witness and observe the referendum of the constitution during my stay in Uzbekistan, which is to ensure the continuation of the the current leadership, as well as to carry out a lot of favorable policies towards this people-centered, people-satisfied development strategy. And this is in line with China's national development strategy, which is also people-centered, people-satisfied. So this will ensure the two countries have more to collaborate rather to confront. And with the external environment being stabilized as well, such as the anti-terrorism by the joint efforts, I think both countries are in this stage of focusing more on the economic development. And you also mentioned in one of your programs regarding the freight train between China and Europe, which
the CKU
in particular will enhance the trade volume and economic cooperation among these three countries. And we now know that there are already 109 starting stations in China to go through this freight train to transport the goods, Chinese goods, automobiles, as well as other supplies to along the Silk Road, along the Belt and Road Initiative. And Uzbekistan will certainly play a key or hub, the role of the hub to enhance not only the bilateral trade and economic cooperation, but also the China and Central Asian countries, and also China and the Europe countries.
Yeah, I heard that there were some technical challenges mm-hmm. back then because countries like Uzbekistan used the wider range for their rail tracks,
yes.
Something like 15...
different
systems.
Different measurements.
And then China uses a different set of systems that mm-hmm. is different from former yeah. Soviet Union mm-hmm. Member states. And now, of course, Uzbekistan been this independent country since 1990s. Are you confident these difficulties can be overcome and this railway, CKU, can be a project bringing great benefits for the region?
Yeah, that was part of the difficulties when the CKU has taken such a long time to do the feasibility study, including the technical issues, including how to tackle the external environment, including but not limited to the terrorism, threats. But now I think after 20 years of its independence, in the 1991, and the country itself, as well as the region, has been stabilizing thanks to the country's determination and the policies to develop themselves, as well as to the neighborhood, to the neighboring countries' joint efforts. So the second stage of its development is to collaborate more, and is to take itself as part of the partner of China and the partner of Europe as well, to be, like I said, the bridge. So I'm confident that the feasibility study as well as the real construction of the CKU will certainly be accelerated and these technical issues will be solved.
Yeah, if completed, I heard that it would be one of the shortest routes connecting the East and the West on land, on the Eurasian landmass. Dr. Khasanov, let's talk about global geopolitics. A lot of Western headlines when they covered this summit, the China-Central Asia summit taking place in Xi'an last week, they focus on the narrative whereby they think that Russia is preoccupied with its war in Ukraine and China is somehow taking over Central Asia. How do you look at that narrative?
So that narrative, it happens, and we see such criticism time to time, and I can say to you that even 50 years ago, nobody in the Western academia or different international research centers didn't believe that China may become a global actor, redefining the global economy and financial system. So China approved that China today can become a serious game changer in global politics. That's why I should say to you that if we read such assessment and such views in academia or for international research, I should say to you that the criticism is a part of the recognition of success. Mm. That's why success in politics worrisome, and the Chinese role, very constructive, very rational role, is irritating because for many researchers, success is irritating, and China is doing very constructive, very rational things in building the very pragmatic relations, not with Central Asian nations with the different global actors. That's why such level of the process in a very constructive way may be perceived by different researchers and academia members and the scholars differently. It happens. That's why I should say to you that the current process of the global development is explained by, let's say, Central Asian scholars in very positive way, because we see the pragmatism, constructivism, and rationalism as main elements, main drivers for the global and regional changes. That's why we have different views, but the current view of my colleagues say that we are in a process of the further improving regional and global relations, having such actor like and partner and neighbor like China. That's why that is very positive, very rational, very pragmatic for us. That's why different views, but we have different attitudes, but it's one of the approaches.
Yeah, exactly. A very interesting perspective there. Also, Han Hua, we noticed that the Russian Prime Minister was in Beijing right after the China Central Asia Summit. What do you think that says about China-Russia relations in light of the China Central Asia Summit?
Actually, he was in Shanghai. Shanghai was his first stop. I'm happy to see that. And in Shanghai, he held a grand, you know, China Russia Business Summit or China Russia Business Forum, which a lot of Russian and the Chinese counterparts participate into this forum to dedicate this forum, as well as the continuous discussions and dialogues, negotiations included, to be part of increasing the trade volumes between the two countries set by the two presidents back in March, which is over $20 million trade volume for this year. And the Russian Prime Minister is very confident to say that the two countries are very determined and very confident to surpass this trade volume this year, which will set a record high trade relationship between the two countries. So I see with the war in Europe is still raging, and we will not forget our main responsibility. As I appreciate the professor just mentioning about China's role as the leading actor on the world stage. So I think this is a good definition regarding the leading role comes with its leading economy, as well as the leading role and the responsibilities. So we will put more focus on this bilateral relationships if this deglobalization is still, you know, being the main narrative in the world. But we also will put a lot of emphasis on the shared future in terms of economic development, cooperation with countries that would like to join the efforts together. And there is a great potential between not only China, Russia, China, Central Asian countries, also between China, Europe, and China, Southeast Asian countries. So there are a lot of complementary factors among these trade relationships. So let business talk, let people-to-people exchange talk, rather than let, you know, this political agenda overarch this normal and should be a basic economic development and the cooperations among the countries.
Definitely. Last night I was chairing a summit of CCPIT attended by the Chamber of Commerce representatives from around the world. It is also their call, their advocacy, that don't let politics get in the way of trade, of investment, and of people-to-people exchange. Thank you so much, Han Hua, and thank you, Dr. Khasanov in Tashkent, Uzbekistan. Thank you very much for your perspectives. And that will do it for this edition of The Hub on CGTN. Thank you all for joining us. I'm Wang Guan in Beijing. Bye and take care.